Hello everyone, welcome back to Act of Learning. Bertrand's paradox, a famous problem in probability posed by Joseph Bertrand, asks for the probability that the length of a random card chosen on a unit circle is greater than the side of an inscribed equilateral triangle. Numberphile made a video on this topic in which Grant showed how the same question can have three possible answers. The paradox shows what happens when we take the words at random a bit too casually. For example, we start with a simpler problem of finding the probability that the distance of a point chosen uniformly randomly in a unit circle from its center is less than 1 by 2. At first glance, we may think that any point chosen will be lying on a radius of a circle. Because of the rotational symmetry of the circle, the actual radius doesn't matter, only where in the radius the point lies. As we are choosing points randomly, the point must lie on average at a distance of less than 1 by 2 for about half the time, and hence the required probability must be 1 by 2. The flaw in this argument lies in misinterpreting the randomness alluded to in the question. When mathematicians say that they are selecting a point uniformly randomly in a circle, it is implied that the probability of a point lying in any area inside the circle is equal to the ratio of the area of that region to that of the circle. For the specific case of a circle of radius r, the probability of a point lying at a distance less than or equal to r is r square. In this video, we are going to talk about the expected length of the cards when we choose the cards with different random methods. We start with the simplest of them, the circumference method. To select a random card, we can choose two points uniformly randomly on the circumference of the circle and connect these points. The endpoints of the card is then uniformly distributed around the circle, giving us a random card. Taking advantage of the circular symmetry, we can always rotate the cards so that the first point chosen is at the south pole of the circle. If we now draw a vertical line, we can again use the circle symmetry with respect to this line and only consider the cards to the right of the line. Drawing a tangent at the bottommost point of the circle, the angle the card makes with the tangent is uniformly distributed between 0 to pi by 2. With simple geometry, we can see that the card created subtends an angle of 2 theta at the center, and the length of the card is twice the sine of theta. Therefore, the expected length of the card in this method is the integral of 2 sine theta with theta uniformly distributed between 0 to pi by 2. That's about 4 by pi, or 1.27. We now move on to the radial line method. Here, we choose a radius uniformly in the interval 0 to 2 pi and then pick a point randomly in this radius. Like we have already discussed, because of the circular symmetry in the problem, what matters is the location of the point on the radius, not the radius itself. If this point is at a distance x from the center, the length of the card is twice the square root of 1 minus x square. As x is uniformly distributed in a radius of length 1, the expected length of the card is the integral of twice the square root of 1 minus x square, as x ranges from 0 to 1. Again, a simple integral that evaluates to pi by 2, or about 1.57. But here's something interesting. If you use x is equal to cos theta in the above integral, the integrand transforms to 2 sine theta times sine theta. The expected value of any random quantity is that random quantity times a measure of that randomness over all points on the sample space. This randomness measure is what we call the probability density function of the random variable. We know that 2 sine theta is the length of the card if we interpret theta as the angle between the card and a tangent at its endpoint. Then whatever remains after that must be the density function of the random variable theta. Let's make a note of this as we'll be needing this later. This density function in this case is sine theta. We now go to the midpoint method. Here we select a random point in the circle as we did in our simple problem at the start of the video and draw a unique card that has this point as its midpoint. If this point is at a distance r from the center, then the length of the card will be twice the square root of 1 minus r square. But r in this case is not uniformly distributed. Remember from our discussion on the simpler problem, we found that the probability of a random chosen point being at a distance less than r from its center is r square. The density function of r is then the differential of this quantity, which is 2r. The expected length of the card in this case is then the integral of twice the square root of 1 minus r square times 2r dr, the density function of r, as r ranges from 0 to 1. An even simpler integral that evaluates to 4 by 3 or about 1.34. But like in the previous case, we can again make a substitution of r equal to cos theta which shows us that the density function of theta is sine of 2 theta. But number 5 also made a video with benchmarks on a related topic where two other methods of drawing a random chord were discussed. In this method, we choose a random point in a circle and draw a line at a random angle through this point to create a chord. There are two random quantities involved here, the distance of the point chosen from the center and the random angle. We can rotate the point so that it lies in the vertical line through the circle's center and draw a horizontal line through this point. We can now take t to be the angle between the horizontal line and the random line we draw to create the chord. Then with some simple geometry, we can show that the length of the chord will be twice the square root of 1 minus r cos theta the whole square. The expected value then in this case is the integral of this quantity times 2r dr, the density function of r, and dt by pi by 2, the density function of t, as r ranges from 0 to 1 and t ranges from 0 to pi by 2. Not a simple integral, but we can evaluate it to 16 by 3 pi, or about 1.697. Because we have a double integral here, it may not be immediately clear whether we can reduce to a 1D integral and find the density function of theta like we did in the cases before. With some simple substitutions, we can indeed show that the density function of theta in this case is 2 sine square theta by pi by 2. Now for our last method in this video, which is not so different from the ones before, here we choose a random radii, then choose a random point in that radii, and then draw a line at a random angle through this point to create the chord. With the terminology that we have defined before, the expected values in this case is the integral of twice 1 minus x cos t the whole square times dx times dt by pi by 2. Evaluating this integral is not a simple thing, but maybe with a software package we can show that the integral is 2 by pi times 2g plus 1, where g is the Catalan's constant, and the expected value comes out to be about 1.802. Like in the previous case, this needs some work to arrive at the density function of theta, and once we solve for it, it eventually comes out to be sine theta times the inverse hyperbolic sine of tan t, the whole divided by pi by 2. The 5 expected values and the density function shows what changes when we interpret the randomness differently in the context of Bertrand paradox from the mathematical standpoint. Because we now have the density functions, we can do much more. We can now find the probabilities in closed form that Ben Sparks found using GeoGebra simulations in the number file video. The problem Ben discusses is to find the probability that two points chosen uniformly in a circle lie on a different sides of a random chord. To start with, we only have to know that the area bounded by a chord that subtends an angle of 2 theta at the center is 2 theta minus sine theta the whole divided by 2. And hence, the probability that a random point lies in this region is this value divided by pi. Needless to say, the probability of a point not lying in this region is 1 minus this value. We now only have to weigh these expressions according to the different density functions based on how the random chord was drawn. With the circumference method, where we chose two points uniformly randomly on the circumference of a circle, we know that theta is uniformly distributed. Using the expression of the probability given theta, we can evaluate this integral and show that the probability is 1 by 3 minus 5 by 4 pi square. With the radial point method, where we selected a random point on a random radial line, the density function is sine theta. The probability in this case comes out to be 128 by 45 pi square. With midpoint method, the one where we select a random point in the circle and draw the unique chord with the selected point as its midpoint, the probability comes out to be 1 by 8 plus 2 by 3 pi square. If we randomly choose a point on the circle and draw a line at a random angle, the probability is surprisingly 1 by 3, like what we would expect from a linear case. Lastly, choosing a random point from a random radius and then drawing a line at a random angle to create the chord, we get a very hard integral that evaluates to about 0.386. To conclude, there is no resolution to the Bertrand's paradox because there is nothing to resolve. What we saw in this video shows that once we make a specific choice on the random method, the probabilities and the expected values are clearly defined. It's just the lack of clarity about the randomness in the question that creates the apparent paradox. Thanks for joining me, and see you in the next video.